Hello everyone and welcome to Boundless Dentistry. In this video we'll talk about specific techniques that are used for the removal of each tooth. First we'll start by briefly talking about different principles that are implied when we extract a tooth, followed by different forces that we use for a given tooth, and then we'll talk about the main objective of our video, that is how do we extract a particular tooth individually, like how an incisor is extracted, premolar and molar. So let's get started. Now, there are two types of extractions mainly. The first is closed extraction and second is open. Now, what do we mean by closed extraction? In closed extraction, basically forceps and elevators are used and there is no surgical incision applied over the area where tooth is being extracted, which is known as the flap. So only forceps and elevator is used. So this is known as closed extraction. Now, talking about open extraction, in open extraction forceps and elevators are used, but in this case the flap is raised. By flap we simply mean the adjacent gingiva that is covering the respective tooth. So we raise that flap so that the tooth can be extracted more easily. Now, open extraction is mainly performed when closed extraction is not possible, or there are certain indications when open extraction is preferred. For example, if the tooth is impacted, there is ankylosis and hypercementosis, and sometimes when the primary molar are submerged, basically because of ankylosis. So these are certain indications when open extractions are performed, but in this video we'll mainly talk about closed extractions. Now, talking about some general principles that are to be implied whenever we are performing extraction of any tooth. So firstly, there is loosen the soft tissue around the tooth that is to be extracted. Now, with this yellow, you can see this is an periosteal elevator. Now, with this periosteal elevator, we loosen this soft tissue that is surrounding the tooth. Now, by loosening this soft tissue, we achieve two objectives. Firstly, we check whether appropriate amount of anesthesia has been applied over here so that the patient doesn't feel pain. Although the patient will experience some amount of pressure, but the patient shouldn't be able to feel pain over here, because that is the main purpose of anesthesia. And secondly, by removing the soft tissue around the tooth, the forceps that are placed over here, you can see over here, they should be placed as apically as possible when extracting a tooth. So the two main purpose of loosening the soft tissue around the tooth is to check whether appropriate amount of anesthesia has been applied over here, and secondly to allow these forceps claw-like structures to grasp the tooth as apically as possible. Now, the second principle that is performed in closed extraction is luxation of the tooth using elevator. Now, by luxation we simply mean that when an elevator is inserted, as you can see over here, interdentally the periodontal ligament basically attaches the bone and the tooth together. So the main purpose of elevator is to tear these periodontal ligament that is present here so that the tooth is loosened in the alveolar bone, and also some amount of expansion also occurs, which is important when extraction is to be performed. So by using elevator we luxate the tooth by tearing the PDLs, and secondly we also expand the alveolar bone so that the tooth is loosened and it can be lifted from the socket of extraction. The elevator is firstly inserted at this mesiobuccal line angle over here, and at perpendicular to the tooth it is rotated in a back and forth manner like this. It's rotated and rotated and moved apically as far as possible to break the periodontal ligament, and secondly at the distobuccal angle as well, the same amount of movement is also performed to break the PDLs over here. Now, the third principle that is used in closed extraction is adapting the forceps. By adapting the forceps, we simply mean that the forceps is grasping the tooth right over here, and the forceps should be placed as apically as possible over the tooth. And secondly, the beaks of the forceps should be parallel to the long axis of the tooth. Now, this is important so that maximum amount of dilation and expansion of the alveolar bone can occur, and this also prevents fracturing of the tooth, because if the forceps beaks are not parallel, there is an increased chance that the tooth might fracture when extracting. And secondly, when we place the forceps beak as apically as possible, the center of rotation of the tooth, which is normally over here, as you can see, if you place the beaks of the forceps as apically as possible, the center of rotation shifts apically. Now this is important because when the center of rotation is present a little more occlusally, there are increased chances that the tooth might fracture when you are extracting it. But when you place the beaks of the forceps apically, there are chances that the center of rotation, and there are high chances that the center of rotation is moved apically over here. So there are decreased chances of fracture of the roots. Now the fourth principle of closed extraction is luxation with forceps. Now when you hold the extracting tooth with the forceps, firstly you have to place the forceps as apically as possible, which we have discussed just now, why is it important. And secondly, when you hold the tooth with the forceps, then you use some buccal force, which we'll discuss shortly, some buccal force and some lingual force here as well. And the forces should not be jerky. When you move the tooth in a buccal direction, you should hold it for several seconds and then release it. And similar for lingual or palatal force as well. And this is important because if the force are jerky, the alveolar bone might not expand as much as you want it, and which might make the extraction more difficult. And now finally, removal of the tooth from the socket. If you have performed these four steps carefully, the tooth is very much loosened in the socket and it is lifted from the socket. Now note, there is a difference between pulling and lifting. Pulling means that greater amount of force has to be applied to the tooth to lift it out of the socket. In this case, we have to lift it from, because by lifting it means it is already loosened in the tooth socket. So we simply apply a little bit of tractional force in this direction and we lift the tooth out of its extraction socket. Now talking about different forces that are applied to a tooth, for example, this is a tooth from a proximal view, and if the tooth is applying force in this direction, this is known as buccal direction, towards the cheek or towards the lips, this force, buccal force, is applied. Similarly, if the force is being applied in a lingual for a mandibular teeth and palatal for maxillary tooth, so this is known as lingual or palatal force. And if you rotate the tooth, in some tooths you can use rotational force, like you hold the tooth like this in the forceps and you rotate it, this is known as rotational force. Apical force is basically, as we have discussed before, forceps are applied and certain amount of apical force downwards is applied to the tooth, so the center of rotation is moved downwards and there are less chances of fracture of the tooth. And then finally, the tractional force is applied. Tractional force, simply a little bit of force is applied so that tooth is lifted from the socket. So these are the five forces, main forces, that are applied for extraction of a tooth, or exodontia if you will. Now talking about the main objective of our video, that is specific techniques that are used for removal of each tooth. Firstly, we'll talk about the maxillary teeth. Now in the maxillary teeth, we'll first talk about incisors. Now you have to note that all of the maxillary teeth, the buccal bone, this bone, is relatively thin as compared to this palatal bone. So in the maxillary tooth, most of the force is applied in a buccal direction because expansion over here is more easily accomplished as compared to palatal bone, because this bone is thicker over here. So when you apply force, there are chances there will be fracture of the bone. So most of the force is applied in maxillary teeth is in the buccal direction. So when you're extracting an incisor, firstly you will use an elevator to break all these periodontal ligament over here and as apically as possible. Then using a forceps, you will apply buccal force, more buccal force as compared to palatal force, as we have discussed right now. And then since the roots of the incisors are conical and there is no bifurcation over here, especially for the central incisor, rotational force can be used. But for lateral incisor, radiographically you have to note if there is any apical distal curvature over here. If there is no curvature, you can simply use rotational force and extract it out. Then apical force is used. You know why we use the apical force? Simply to move the center of rotation as apically as possible to prevent the fracture of a tooth. And then finally, after performing all of these forces, the alveolar bone is now expanded more in the buccal direction, which we have to accomplish, and there is breakdown of the PDLs and expansion of the bone. Then finally we use the tractional force to lift the tooth out of the socket. Now talking about maxillary canine is one of the longest tooth present in the oral cavity, and since it has a very long root, there is a greater surface area for attachment of PDL. So even though the labial bone of this maxillary tooth is thin as compared to parietal bone, there is difficulty in extraction of maxillary canine simply because of the greater amount of surface area that is available for the attachment of PDL. So there is some hindrance when maxillary canine is extracted. So in this case also, we use elevator to break down the PDLs, and then we use more buccal force because, as we have discussed before, the labial bone is thinner as compared to parietal bone, so less amount of parietal force is applied. We use apical force, and we can also use rotational force over here. But note, when we are extracting maxillary canine, there is a chance that this buccal bone might fracture. So there are certain indications to it. When a surgeon feels that small amount of bone has broken, extraction process can continue. But when large amount of bone has been extracted, or your surgeon feels that a large portion of bone has been mobilized, the surgery process should stop as soon as possible, and then you evaluate whether the bone is attached to periosteum or not. If the bone is attached to the periosteum, you simply lift the flap and you leave the bone over the periosteum and extract the tooth. But if the large portion of the bone has been removed along with the tooth, you simply take out the bone and do not leave it over there, because it simply is a non-vital bone, and if you leave it over there, the healing process will prolong as compared to if you remove the bone along with the maxillary canine. So you use more buccal force as compared to parietal force, you apply apical force, rotational force can also be used, and then finally, after performing all of these forces, tractional force is used to remove the tooth out of its socket. Now talking about maxillary first premolar. Now when we are talking about a tooth with bifurcated or trifurcated roots, rotational force cannot be used, because when you use rotational force, the roots will fracture. So you have to be careful with that, and you have to see that radiographically. Now in this case, you can see buccal force is more used as compared to parietal force. So when you use more buccal force, but more than required buccal force is used, there is chances of fracturing of this buccal root. Same goes for parietal force. Now if you apply parietal force, there is chances of fracturing of this parietal root. Now there is a difference between the labial and the parietal root. The labial root, if it fractures, it is easier to retrieve as compared to parietal root. So if a fracture is to occur, it's better for the surgeon that if the labial roots fracture occur as compared to parietal root. And that is because there is an increased likelihood, and especially the most common root fracture that occurs in the oral cavity is of this maxillary first premolar. So one important thing that has to be emphasized over it is that maximum amount of luxation has to occur so that there is a decreased chances of fracturing the roots, especially the parietal root, which is difficult to retrieve when it's fractured. So you use more amount of buccal force, hold it there and expand the buccal bone, because as we have talked before, the maxillary teeth, all of them have thin buccal bone as compared to parietal bone, so buccal bone is easier to expand. So you use more amount of buccal force, less parietal force, no rotational force because there is bifurcation, two roots are present, and then after appropriate amount of luxation when the tooth is loosened, then you finally lift the tooth out of its socket by using tractional force. Now talking about maxillary second premolar, there is in most cases no bifurcation present, so it is relatively easier to extract as compared to first premolar. So you use elevator to break all the periodontal ligament over here, then you use more buccal force, less parietal force, apical force is used to move the center of rotation as apically as possible to prevent the fracture of the root, And then finally, after performing all these, you use a traction force to simply lift the second premolar maxillary out of its socket and extracting it. Now, talking about molars, when you're extracting maxillary molar, there is one anatomic structure that is present around them which has to be noted radiographically before you are extracting a molar, and that is maxillary sinus, which is present just close to the roots of the maxillary molar. So that is to be appreciated radiographically, the maxillary sinus, before you're extracting a maxillary molar. So if, for example, the maxillary sinus is close, very close to the roots, so you shouldn't use apical force, because if you use apical force, you might perforate the maxillary sinus, and which then leads to further complication, like, for example, oroenteral fistula can form when you extract this tooth because you have perforated the maxillary sinus. So if very thin bone is present over the maxillary sinus close to the roots, then it is better to perform an open extraction as compared to closed extraction. But if the maxillary sinus is quite far from the roots of the maxillary molar, then you can easily and quite comfortably perform closed extraction. So this is one anatomic feature that you have to note before you perform the extraction of maxillary molars. Now, talking about some anatomy of the maxillary molars, the roots are very divergent. There are two buccal roots and there is one more divergent palatal root. So because the roots are very divergent, no rotational force is to be used because it will simply lead to fracture of the roots. Now, in this case also, more buccal force is used as compared to palatal force because palatal bone is more thicker, so expansion is to occur more in the buccal direction as compared to palatal. Now, the forceps that is used to extract the maxillary molars has two beaks. The one beak has three projections, something like this. It has a projection over it, and this projection is inserted over the buccal side so that it fits into the buccal bifurcation that is present, and over the palatal side a rounded beak of the forceps is used, something like this. So it's this rounded portion of the forceps is inserted palatally. So when you're extracting the maxillary molar, you first apply the buccal force and hold it over there, and then you apply some palatal force, hold it over there, expansion of the bone occurs. And as for premolar, it is better to, if fracture is to occur, of the buccal roots as compared to palatal, because palatal root is difficult to retrieve if it is fractured. So it is better to fracture the buccal roots as compared to palatal root. So more buccal force is to use because that prevents the fracture of the palatal roots. And then we apply apical force, but apical force, as we have discussed before, it is to be carefully applied. If, for example, the maxillary sinus is very close, it might perforate it, so you have to be careful. And after performing all of this, traction force is used to remove the first molar out of its socket. Now, similar principles that are discussed right now for the first molar is to be applied for the second molar as well, but since the root of the second molars are less divergent as compared to first molar, extraction is relatively easy as compared to first molar. Talking about third molar has a very, very divergent anatomy. It mostly, if it's erupted and is present in the oral cavity, its extraction is relatively straightforward and can even be performed by using only elevators. But if the tooth is impacted and it's very divergent roots and anatomy is very divergent, then closed extraction cannot be performed and mostly open extractions are performed. Now, talking about mandibular teeth. Now, in mandibular teeth also, except molars, we are not considering molars right now, except molars, the buccal or the labial bone of all the mandibular teeth is thin as compared to lingual bone. In case of molars, the lingual bone is now thin as compared to the labial or buccal bone. So, except molars, more like for maxilla, more amount of labial or buccal force is applied. So, talking about anteriors over here, anteriors of the mandibular teeth are one of the most easiest tooth to extract. So when you're extracting mandibular anteriors, same, the elevators are used and you luxate and break the PDLs, and then more amount of labial force is used as compared to lingual force, and then apical force is used to move the center of rotation as apically as possible. Then you use rotational force because the roots are very small and conical, and because of that there is increased chance of fracture of this as well. So you have, but retrieving the fractured root is easy. We use root tip instrument to extract the broken roots. So finally, using tractional force, the tooth is lifted out of its socket. Now, talking about mandibular premolars, these are one of the most easiest tooth to extract in the oral cavity, one of the most easiest, because roots are conical, single root, and they are very easily extracted. Same principles are applied over here. You place the forceps beak as apically as possible. We use the elevator first to break down the PDLs over here. Place the forceps as apically as possible. We use more buccal force, and lingual force is applied but less as compared to buccal bone, because as we have discussed, this is thinner in mandibular premolar. So more buccal force is applied as compared to lingual force. Apical force is used to move the center of rotation as apically as possible. Rotational force is also applied, because since the roots, they don't have, in many of the cases there is no bifurcation, single conical root is present, the rotational force is used, and then finally tractional force is used to lift the tooth out of its socket. Now lastly, talking about mandibular molars, now there are certain differences when extracting mandibular molar as compared to other tooth that are extracted in the oral cavity. Now in this mandibular molars, the lingual bone is now thinner as compared to the buccal bone or the labial bone. Now since this is the case, more lingual force is to be applied as compared to the buccal force. And also when the forceps are applied to the crown, the forceps have two beaks, and both the beaks have a conical projection like this. And this both conical, or this conical, or you can say three-sided beaks are applied over at the tooth, and the tooth is extracted. And more lingual force is applied as compared to the buccal force. Now the tooth is simply luxated by applying the elevators, break the PDL ligaments, apply the forceps as apically as we can possibly, then we apply more lingual force, less buccal force. There is no rotational force, since you can see the mandibular molars mostly have two roots, the mesial root and the distal root. So no rotational force is used. Apical force is used to move the center of rotation as apically as possible to prevent the fracture of the root. And finally, after applying all of these forces, tractional force is used to lift the tooth out of its socket. Now this was for mandibular first molar. Similar principles are to be used when extracting second molar. Now talking about third molar, since third molars have different anatomies, their extraction varies. Sometimes close extraction can be used when the tooth is properly erupted in the oral cavity, but in most of the times this is not the case. Sometimes the tooth is impacted. So when it's impacted, closed extraction is relatively less performed as compared to open extractions, because the flap is to be raised. So in that cases, in mandibular third molar, mostly open extraction is performed, because anatomy is very divergent, and it most of the time doesn't allow the surgeon to perform closed extraction. So this was all about specific techniques that are used for extraction or performing exodontia of each tooth that is present in the oral cavity. We also discussed forces, different forces that are applied to the tooth, and we also then discussed general principles that are to be considered when extracting tooth in a closed extraction manner. So I hope this video was useful for you. And if you like this video, please like, share, and subscribe, and press the bell icon. So see you next time in our further videos. Take care, and thank you for watching this video.